This is a lecture on taxonomy and phylogeny. Taxonomy is the classification of organisms based on their structures, and phylogeny is classifying them based on their evolutionary relationship. Taxonomy is the newer way of classification, whereas taxonomy has been around for some time. Classification is the grouping of objects based on physical similarities. We do this for all types of different objects. As humans, we like to have things in order, and we like to put them in groups based on how they are the same. We do the same thing with organisms, and we call that taxonomy. This is predominantly based on morphology, which means the characteristics that an organism has or what it looks like. Not necessarily what its internal structures are or its behaviors, but basically just how it looks. The individuals that came up with this system are Carolus Linnaeus and John Whittaker. They created this organizational system that was still somewhat used today. There are 8 levels of taxonomy. Carolus Linnaeus used from kingdom through species. Domain was added later. They are on this list in order from the most broad domain to the most specific species. You should be able to name these in order from largest to smallest. The easy way for me to remember is to create a mnemonic device using the first letter of each of the words. The sentence that I remember is, "Daring King Philip came over 4 great spaghetti." If I can remember that sentence and the first letter of each of those words, it makes it much easier to remember the order of taxonomic classification. The domains are relatively new class that was added to this classification system. There are 3 domains. 2 of those domains consist of prokaryotic organisms, domain archaea, which is also called archaebacteria, and domain bacteria. These both consist of cells that do not contain a nucleus. In the domain archaea, consists primarily of organisms that are thought to be more ancient or live in very extreme environments. Things like geysers or at the bottom of the ocean, maybe way high up in the atmosphere. Places that you wouldn't necessarily expect there to be life at all will often have archaea bacteria living there. In the domain bacteria, this contains all of the modern bacteria, the type of bacteria that live inside of your body, the kind that make you sick, and the kind that live in your digestive system and help you to digest your food. Anything that is modern would be in this domain bacteria. Anything that is newly discovered as an ancient bacteria, maybe in a fossil, would fall into domain archaea, as well as things that live in extreme environments. Any organism that is made up of eukaryotic cells falls into the domain eukarya. So in eukarya, we have plants, animals, fungus, and also protists. Protists are single-celled organisms that do have a nucleus, things such as amoebas or plankton. Using this classification system, we can group organisms into smaller and smaller groups based on their characteristics. So if you look at this table here, all of these things would fall into the domain of eukarya. The fungus, the mushrooms there, the shaggy mane mushroom, splits off quite early in a different kingdom from the 2 cats, the bobcat and the lion. It immediately splits into the fungi kingdom and gets more specific by group through there. The phylum that both of these cats are in is Chordata, meaning that it has a spinal cord. They're both in the class Mammalia, meaning that they're mammals, they have hair, and they give birth to live young. Their order is Carnivora, meaning they eat meat, and the family is Felidae, so they're feline. Then they split into 2 separate groups, where the bobcat is in the genus Lynx, the lion is in the genus Panthera. So as we move down in this classification system, the groupings get more and more specific, so fewer and fewer members are found in each group. Until you get to the species, that consists only of organisms that are able to produce, to reproduce, and have fertile, viable offspring. Taxonomists give unique scientific names to these species, whether it's alive today or extinct. Careful not to confuse this with the taxidermist, as that is someone who stuffs dead animals. Not the same thing. This taxonomic name is often called a scientific name, and it comes from one of 2 dead languages, either Latin or ancient Greek. They're dead languages because no one speaks them anymore, although we can still write in them and still read them, and other languages are heavily based on them, There are no countries that use that as their primary language. So why would we want to use a dead language in order to name organisms? Well, I'm going to give you an example in pictures. Here's a picture of a devil cat, a ghost cat, mountain lion, screaming cat, puma, Florida panther. Don't worry, that's its baby. It's not eating it. It's carrying it. And a cougar. In case you didn't notice, those were all the same animal. But there's at least 50 common names for that animal that was shown, depending on the area that you live in. So common names, one reason that we use a dead language is because common names vary according to region. If you live in one area of the country, you call that animal one thing, and if you live in another area, you call it by a different name. And if you are a scientist that is trying to study this animal, you'd want to have just one name that can be used to describe all of the members of that species, not a lot of different names depending on the area. Another reason is because languages evolve. If you consider the language, the English that Shakespeare spoke, it's not really the same English that you speak today. If a language is commonly used, then that changes over time. Different words have different meanings, and we don't want to have the meaning of a scientific name change over time. The third reason is we don't want to give any particular culture or country preferential treatment in these namings. So, just because you live in a specific region of the world, that doesn't necessarily mean that the scientific name should be in your language. So that's why we use scientific names based on Latin, for those three primary reasons. And we use this method called binomial nomenclature. It's a two-part naming system used for writing the scientific names. The genus of this organism is always written first, and it is always capitalized. And then the second word is the species, and it is never capitalized. Both words are italicized if they're typed, or underlined if they're handwritten, because you can't italicize your handwriting. So the example given here is the name for that mountain lion cougar puma that you just looked at, Felis concolor. Why? Here we have abbreviated the first genus, the first word there, and you can do that if you use the same scientific name over and over, but you wouldn't want to do that the first time that you use it in an article. Felis would be the genus, and concolor is the species. It's italicized to show that that is its scientific name, the genus is capitalized, and the species is lowercase. Make sure if you're writing a scientific name that you always use this format. Cladistics is the more common or the more updated version of classification now. This is a relatively new system, and it's based on derived traits that establish evolutionary relationships. A derived trait is a feature that evolved within a group under consideration. So, for example, and I'll give you some examples in just a few minutes. A phylogenetic tree, or a cladogram, is based on these evolutionary relationships and shows how organisms are related to one another based on those characteristics. An outgroup is a term that's used to describe the least related group. We will always find those on the far left of our diagrams. Here are some examples. At the top, I have an example using automobiles, or modes of transportation. All of these have wheels, a horse-drawn cart, car, plane, and space shuttle. All of them have wheels, and so that's a derived characteristic for that entire group. But a horse-drawn cart does not have an engine, so that one splits off early and is shown on the far left as our outgroup. All cars, planes, and space shuttles all have engines, so that is a derived character for that group. Then the car splits off because it does not contain the next character, which is wings. Plane and a space shuttle contain those, so that is a derived character of that group. The other example at the top, fish, amphibians, mammals, and reptiles all contain a backbone. But fish do not have four limbs, so they are the outgroup. They branch off first and are shown on the far left. Amphibians, mammals, and reptiles all have four limbs, so that is a derived character for that group. Mammals and reptiles have a water-type egg, and so that is a derived characteristic of those groups. The mammal's egg remains internal, while the reptile's egg is external. Notice how on the top, they are all of the organisms are lined up along the top of this cladogram. That shows that they are all modern organisms. If you arrange it the way it is on the bottom, where there are species branching off down here, and they're not all aligned at the top. This implies that these species are ancestors to these species. This would mean that these are extinct, and that these are their descendants. If there are modern organisms, they should be found along the top, like this. See if you can answer these questions while looking at this cladogram. Which of those organisms is the most derived, and who is the outgroup? What is a shared derived trait for a pigeon? What is a shared derived trait for mice? If you had to put monkeys on this cladogram, where would be the best place to put them? The most derived means that it's an organism that has the most derived characteristics or is the most advanced, so that would be the chimp. The outgroup is the one on the far left that has the least number of derived characteristics, so that would be the hagfish. A shared derived trait for a pigeon would be feathers. That's something that none of the other characteristics have and is very specific to this group. A shared derived trait for mice would also be shared with chimps, and that would be fur or mammary glands. The best place for monkeys would be up here, because they also contain fur and mammary glands, but are probably more closely related to the chimp than they are to the mouse, so branching off somewhere here would probably be the best place for a monkey. Please contact your instructor if you're having trouble answering any of these questions. That concludes the lecture on this taxonomy and classification. If you have any questions, please make sure to contact your instructor, scroll down, and complete the assignments for this week. Thank you.